Evil is hot.
Evil is hot.
Don't tell me that it's not, 'cause evil is hot.
The hell has evil got that makes it so
tell you, if you don't at least vaguely recognize that music, you either avoid musicals like the plague or have lived under a rock for the past 20 or so years, because this thing is big, bigger than I thought it was, bigger still than what I now know it to be. This thing is a thing. This thing is Phantom of the Opera. My God, little did I know about the popularity of Phantom. It's huge. It's hailed as one of, if not the greatest musical of all time. It has multiple films, literature, and stage performances of it. Phantom of the Opera is a thing. After examining it and its lore for the past week or so, much to my disbelief, I'm starting to see why. The uninitiated, Phantom of the Opera was, in its most well-known form, a 1986 stage musical by Andrew Lloyd Webber starring Michael Crawford and Sarah Brightman, and a film adaptation in 2005 starring Gerard Butler and random singer chick I don't know. But its expansive adaptation and tribute list goes on and on, well beyond that of film and stage. This thing has been parodied by both Simpsons and South Park. It has legions of artistic fans dedicating pictures to it, its music being one of its more notable features. Has been covered and remastered a dozen times. Its more loyal covers epicifying it beyond belief. I mean, you should hear some of this stuff.
Your spirit and my voice in one combined. The stars above the horizon.
Did this all start? What could have sparked such a tidal wave of love for a story that in this day and age hardly seems new and exciting? Well, the answer is how most things that break the popularity scale start out. A book. And this is where I began my Phantom examination with the very first Phantom of the Opera story, the original. This is where it all started. In 1910, a French lawyer by the name of Gaston Leroux decided to try his hand at writing, and fueled by his fascination with the legend of the ghost in the Grand Parisian Opera House, wrote the tale of Christine Daae, Raoul Duchesnay, and Eric. Yeah, the Phantom's real name is Eric. Believe me, that's not the most obscure thing about this story. Our story begins at the Paris Opera, where a bunch of ballerinas are panicking because the youngest one, named Meg Jury, claims to have seen a ghost. They all continue to freak out for some time until their technical den mother, Madame Jury, tells them to shut up and get back to work because they need to impress their new directors who are coming that night. Also, a guy named the Persian is there too. The new directors, Richard and Moncharem, are at that moment being briefed by their predecessors. They're told where everything is, what operas are the biggest sellers, who the best singers are, that they should pay blackmail to a ghost every month. Wait, what? Yep, as part of being a director, you're also a slave to the opera house ghost, having to do whatever he says whenever he says it. Naturally, the new directors don't believe and think the old directors are just kidding, or perhaps are crazy. But just then, Madame Jury bursts in and announces that a stagehand named Joseph Bouquet has been found hanging under the stage. So, all the ballerinas, the old directors, and pretty much everyone else claims it's the ghost. Except Moncharmin and Richard, who laugh about it. Even though a man is dead. Also, the Persian is there. Everyone but the new directors start to run about in terror, and the directors still remain convinced that all these people are just playing up the ghost thing for laughs. Even though a man is dead. The ghost then shows up to say, "What's up? I just killed a guy." Even then, they still think it's a joke. Really, guys? Really? So at long last, we are finally introduced to one of our mains, Viscount Raoul Duchesnay. I've learned to hate this character. His problem is that he's fallen in love with chorus girl now-turned-diva Christine Daae after seeing her sing a leading role so well she passes out on stage. Her performance is so beautiful that it brings him to sobbing, which turns out isn't difficult. He then vows to have her. So after sneaking backstage with his brother Philippe, he makes his way to Christine's dressing room to make sure that he is the first thing she sees when she wakes up. Seriously, that's what he says. He then proceeds to stare at the still unconscious Christine until she wakes up. And then, while she is still dazed, tells her how much he loves her. 'Cause that's not creepy. Christine responds to this in the only reasonable fashion. by politely asking who the hell he is. Raoul apologizes and introduces himself as the boy who rescued her scarf from the ocean. What? This only serves to confuse Christine more, and she demands the doctor make him leave. Raoul tries to argue this, that since he loves her, he should stay with her. But he's thrown out. But rather than just going home, he decides to wait outside Christine's dressing room until she comes out herself. He sits there for apparently about 3 hours until anything interesting happens. That interesting thing being that he hears a man's voice coming from Christine's room. He listens in and hears the man confess love for Christine and Christine share the sentiment. This flies him into a jealous rage, and as Christine leaves her dressing room, Raoul hides and waits for the man to come out so he can attack him. When after a while, another approximate 3 hours, no one comes out, Raoul breaks down, cries, and goes home. Our hero, everyone. The next bulk of the book follows suit with this. Raoul does something stalkery, Christine rejects him, something ominous and supernatural happens, Raoul cries. Repeat for the next 5 chapters. His attempts at wooing include hiding in her dressing room after performances, following her home and staring at her house, staring at her with a sad look on his face again and again and again and again, and my personal favorite, following her to her father's gravesite and telling her that her father is dead forever and nothing can bring him back. Did I mention how much I don't like Raoul? I really hope I did. Fortunately, though, we have our directors to give us a break from Raoul, as they feud with the ever-growing impatience of the Opera House ghost, at this point introduced to them as the Phantom of the Opera. Directors outright refuse the Phantom his blackmail money, despite his threats, and even at one point receive a letter from him giving them one last chance. It basically says that they should, 1. Not perform the musical known as Faust, 2. Cast Christine in the lead of the musical that definitely should not be Faust, and 3. Make his box ready for him so he can watch, not Faust. The directors, now very sick of this joke, decide to do something a little different. 1. Perform Faust. 2. Cast a woman named Carlotta instead of Christine in the lead. And 3. Sit in the Phantom's box themselves to watch Faust. The Phantom gives them one more warning, saying if they go through with this, he will do something terrible to Carlotta. Directors once again ignore, and the show begins. On the night of the show, it's a full house, the directors are in the Phantom's box, Carlotta is singing wonderfully, Raoul is watching Christine sing her chorus bits while crying, and the Persian is once again kinda there. Richard and Moncham are feeling pretty good, until the opening of the third act hits. The Phantom said something terrible was gonna happen? I wonder if something terrible happens. Well, yeah, it does. As the directors look on in disbelief, the Phantom appears behind them and comments, Wow, this is so terrible, I bet that giant chandelier could fall. 3 guesses what happens next. It's at this point that Christine finds Raoul and says, Yeah, I kinda have a thing going with the Opera House ghost, but I think he may be kinda crazy. Turns out the Phantom of the Opera had come to Christine as the Angel of Music and was teaching her how to sing, fell in love with her, and was now possessive and jealous. Raoul is overjoyed at the news and starts to cry with happiness, thinking that this means she is now his. Christine tries to explain the danger he's in because the Phantom is kind of strangle-happy with people he doesn't like, but Raoul giddily explains that the Phantom couldn't possibly exist and that this Angel of Music wasn't the ghost of her father. Raoul, dude, I think she knows that. At least I really hope she does. Turns out Christine had been visiting the Phantom for a couple of weeks now and was perfectly content with him doting on her, singing to her, and buying her nice things, till she pulled off his mask and saw the hideous deformity that plagues him from the nose up. This instantly turned him into a monster in her mind and turned her deep love of Eric into fearful hate. Confesses to Raoul that she does in fact remember that whole scarf ocean thing that he'd mentioned earlier, but didn't want to lose Eric over a childhood friend. Raoul at long endless last believes her story and vows to destroy Eric. To his surprise, Christine begs him not to. This causes Raoul to ask the question on most everyone's mind at this point. Would Christine love Raoul if Eric was handsome? Her answer beats around the bush for a little bit, but finally culminates into a very, very blunt no.
What?
That is seriously the most shallow thing I've ever heard. Or read, I guess. The only reason she doesn't love Eric is because he's ugly? He kills people! That would be a valid reason, but ugly. He's not even that ugly. He can go buy you stuff out in public by popping on a mask. How ugly can he be? How about the fact that he lives in a cave? That's a good reason. He treats you better than Raoul does. He shares your interests, spends time with you, and before saying he loves you. But nope, he's ugly. Can't happen. How about the fact that he kidnaps you twice? That would make sense. Oh, no, 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 no. She just goes on to say that ugliness is literally the only reason they can't be together. Book effectively thrown against wall. That, people, is why I like this book so much. It can elicit that kind of reaction from me and still make me want to keep reading. I'll summarize. The ending ends up with a kidnapping, the directors being forced against one another, attempted terrorism, the Persian finally having a point, and Raoul acting like a dumbass 3 separate times over the course of 5 minutes. Is it a good ending? Yes. But it's very bittersweet. But that's how it should be. The reason the Phantom of the Opera works so well as a love story because it has a very realistic and almost low opinion of love. Both Christine suitors have very evident flaws, and they can show the worst but very real parts about romance that other stories refuse to look at. Love can make monsters of good people, but in the end, it can also bring out the best in anyone. That's kind of a beautiful message, even though someone will always and inevitably be hurt in the end. Or have a chandelier dropped on them.
If you marry me, I'll live for you and break for you. If you marry me, I'll scrub for you and bake for you. If you marry me, all others I'll forsake for you. All this will I do if you marry me. All this will I do.